Scene Daddy Interviews.
Welcome everyone to Scene Daddy Interviews. My name is Ian, and this is really cool because tonight, right now on the phone, I have Eli of Boys of Fall. Eli, man, how are you doing tonight?
I'm doing so good. Doing so good. Very happy to be here with you.
Thank you very much, man. I know this was relatively short notice. We talked a little bit off air. It sounds like you're going to have this down, so I am very excited to do this.
I am too, man. Thanks for having me. I hope I don't screw it up too much. We'll see how it goes.
That would be extremely funny if you get called in to do this last minute and then you say something absolutely ridiculous that just ruins the entire band. Not to put any pressure on you or anything.
No, it would, but it would be just my luck. I mean, I seem to have pretty bad fortune with almost everything I do sometimes. So it'd be just my luck, and I think the guys would agree.
Well, I gotta at least say this. I mean, that might be true in your personal life. That might be true in some other things. But Boys of Fall right now, I mean, I can't go anywhere without hearing people talk about the band. And that's not blowing smoke. That's just real truth right there. So we definitely got to talk about a lot of Boys of Fall. You had the, you know, the deluxe edition of Better Moments come out very recently. You've been on, you know, on tour promoting it as well. How's the tour been going?
The tour went great, man. You know, we revisited a lot of markets that we had been hitting. You know, basically how the tour came about was we needed something to do this year. We had been submitting for, you know, there's a lot of bands at our level and it's really competitive. And so, at the time we didn't have an agent, for most of the year, actually our entire career, we really haven't had a booking agent. So, you know, we were just trying to submit for support tours and nobody would really, wanted to, you know, it's just, it, like I said, it's hyper competitive. So, we didn't really land anything. And then we were like, you know what? The label wants us to put out this deluxe edition record. So let's put it out and let's go to some of our best markets and just see how we do. At least, you know, at the very least, we're going to get active. We're going to release some singles. We've got we released a song with Keizo, the EDM artist. And then, you know, just got announced we're going to be doing a remix with Lil Xan on one of our songs. So it's just like, you know, like the fall of this year is hyping up. So like, let's hit the road and man, it went great. Like I said, we hit up, you know, a lot of some of our best markets. I got to see a lot of familiar faces and I'm telling you what, man, like, you know, we went out solo. Like we didn't have a tour package. So that was just kind of scary too. I mean, we just basically did a whole line of local shows everywhere. And
that's crazy.
To really see the growth in some of these markets was just incredible. You know, incredible for us. It was something that it just happened at the right time, you know, and to be able to see that growth really means a lot to us. It, you know, it's further validation that we're, you know, doing the right thing.
Yeah. No, for sure. And I think you brought up something extremely interesting, especially in the scene right now. There seems to be a split in the way tours are done, where you'll have a tour where it's almost all the same genre. So you'll have all hardcore bands, and then you'll have all metalcore bands. And then there's another side of touring where they want every different genre almost put into that tour package, and they go off like that. So that way you're, you know, if you go with everyone the same, you pretty much know if you like that genre, you're going to like those bands. And then obviously, the opposite is true for when you have all the different genres. You're trying to, you know, put your music out there to people that might not hear it all the time. With your band, you've gone through so much in the years of being Boys of Fall that you've got so many genres mixed into what you do. Is that what kind of hinders you, besides the competition? Is it also just trying to find the right bunch of bands to go out with you just based on the genres that you play?
That's a great question. I think you're so right about touring right now. You know, like I just saw, like we're really big fans of Don Broco and like,
oh yeah,
they did a US run with like, they had like Periphery was on the lineup and it was just like, that's crazy. Right. But to answer your question, I think that it very well could hold us back, you know, like, but at the same time, you know, we look at it very from a business perspective, and like our numbers on Spotify look great.
Yeah.
We have a lot of our fans that listen to us on Spotify actually go out to shows.
Right.
And from what we've been told by our distributor, that's pretty unique. That's rare. So we've got this like really passionate fan base. To be quite honest with you, dude, and I'm not trying to scapegoat out of the question. Not sure why it's so difficult, or it has been so difficult. I think, I just think it's so competitive, and to be truthful about it, like, I know that we're not trendy either, you know, so maybe that has something to do with it. I mean, we're just on the steady incline.
Right.
But it's just not this like rapid, like, we went viral kind of a thing, you know?
Sure.
So it's just like, it's just a very slow growth that's just been growing and growing and growing over the years. And I think that probably has something to do with it, whereas there's just not a lot of people who, you know, maybe they've heard of us, but they don't see the value in us, you know?
Okay.
That we see, that we know is there, that right. we bring to the table. So, you know, from a supporting perspective, like, I mean, I really think that we could hold our own on a larger tour supporting another band, but
absolutely.
For a big band, you know, like when we went out on a headliner, we were picky too, you know, like you want to take the right people out, and you want, first of all, to throw, you know, to make that ticket that those kids buy, like you want that to be worth it, you know,
yeah.
you want them to buy the ticket. So if there's a band that you don't think is going to draw, you know, like, are you willing to take that risk? Especially bigger bands where like, this is their income. This is their livelihood. You know, from a business perspective, I do understand it. I just wish that they really truthfully knew our value. You know,
right.
I do think that we draw a lot of kids in certain markets, and seeing what we've done on our own without an agent, without any support tours, like, we've done so well for ourselves, and I think that we could do well for others, you know.
Yeah.
Too. So, yeah, it's just crazy competitive.
No, absolutely. And it's funny that you brought up Don Broco. I was actually at their first headlining show that they did recently on this tour. They have Sleep On It. They have Trash Boat. Like, it was great. I've actually talked to the guys before on a previous show. And it's funny you brought them up, because I actually think you guys would do really well on a tour with them. Just all the different mixing of genres just seems to work so well between the two of you.
Oh man, yeah. I mean, they're like, Don Broco has been like, we've been a fan of them since like before they came to the US. Like,
yeah.
I think we started listening to them just before Automatic came out.
Oh,
so like, they were still on the Priorities album cycle.
Mm-hmm.
And Mike, you know, singer of our band, like, he liked them so much that he bought, because their music wasn't available in the US. Like, you could get it on YouTube, but like, it was pretty limited.
Right.
So he bought two of their CDs from a European store, and then had them shipped to the United States so that we could like listen to their music.
Yeah.
So we've been huge fans of them. And I like, they're an influence on us in the sense of like, we definitely came from a pop punk and post hardcore world.
Mm-hmm.
But like, what was really inside of us was just that mature sound. And I know they've kind of changed their sound a lot, but like Automatic for us, like their album Automatic was just like that, really, because I'm a bass player, and
yeah.
to see Tom play bass the way that he does, you know, that's like exactly how I play.
Gotcha.
And have always played, but I've had to change my style based on the genre I was playing. And he's just like, that band is fearless. Like, they just play the music they want to play.
Right.
And I think that like, when our band came back, we took that and just ran with it, and was just like, let's be true to who we are, you know, who we've always been, like that pop punk band, but let's blend it with this mature step forward that we all want to take musically.
Right.
And yeah, dude, we actually got the chance to meet them. They came to the US with on a run with State Champs back a couple years ago.
Yeah.
And, they like have no idea who we are, but dude, we are so obsessed with them. And like, so we went out to the show, we bought them shots, and we hung out with them and stuff.
There you
and
go.
I got to talk to Tom a little bit, and I just told him, I was like, dude, thank you for like what you're doing for bass. Like, you,
yeah.
you know, you're like in a world of like breakdowns and stuff, like you're bringing the groove back, you know?
Right. No, that's very true. That's very
yeah.
true. Well, I'll go back to something you mentioned before, you know, the coming back part. So yeah. Obviously, you know, the band decided to step aside, you know, after Thank You and Goodnight. And then you came back later with signing with InVogue Records. Do you think that that hindered you at all? Because obviously you wanted to come back. Fans of yours wanted you to come back. But do you think that's kind of hindered you now with getting tours and making music that people might have thought, oh, wait a second, I thought this band was gone and now they're back. Can I trust that?
Truthfully, I would say that if people are hearing about us now, like from the fresh perspective, they don't know that about us.
Right.
That's what I've ran into, is that people like didn't know that about us. I think we've got enough of a touring history since we've been back to where we are reliable. You see the growth. Like if you really look at the numbers, we're doing well enough. I'm not sure that held us back with touring. Yeah. What it did hold us back with was just a label being interested from the beginning. InVogue was the main one that was like really interested, didn't care. But a lot of the ones that we were getting shopped to like the band, like the music, but they were really put off by the fact that we weren't technically a band, you know, like at that time we started shopping before we were even announced that we were going to come back, you know, so they liked the numbers. They liked what it was, what it became. But it, you know, the fact of the matter was that like that scared labels off. Mm-hmm. But I think now, you know, I think we've kind of turned the table on that history a little bit.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm not sure so much it holds us back anymore. It could, but I think we're reliable enough on the tours we've been on and, you know, have enough of a history there to where it's kind of, I don't know, it's kind of glossed over that part of our history. And I think it's actually I wear it like a badge. Like, I think it's a really special thing that happened, actually. I don't think that it's a bad thing. In my personal life, I was able to grow up a little bit. I got to live my life without music for a while and knew that like I can't live my life like that ever again.
Sure.
So on a personal level, that was great. But, you know, on a professional level, like nobody knew who the hell we were. And we just put this music out and it did its own work on its own. Like, we didn't promote it. We didn't, you know, we put the album out and we broke up and it like, I'm not gonna, it definitely didn't go viral, but like, I mean, we had before we got signed, I think like 50 or 40,000 monthly listeners on Spotify.
Right. Right.
That just people discovered us and loved our band and loved our music. And these, and that's who always mattered, you know, to us, was just people, you know. Yeah. We didn't understand why nobody liked us, except people did, like our fans did.
Yeah.
You know, but professionals in the industry, for whatever reason, didn't want to work with us. And that ended up leading us to breaking up. But then, I don't know, man, people speak for themselves. People like what they like. They consume what they consume. And we're a part of that appetite, you know.
Right. Oh, yeah.
And it means the world to us because it was just validation, you know. After a year and a half, it was like, oh, man, maybe we actually were onto something. Maybe we were good, you know.
Yeah.
Because I think like our biggest fear, like why we ended up breaking up too, is it's not why, but a part of it was, is just like, dude, maybe we and our like our local fan base, like things were really good. And like at the time, Mike was starting the Jared Alonji stuff. And,
right.
You know, it's like maybe these people who like work with us think we're good, but like maybe we're not actually that good. Like maybe we're like kind of bad, you know. It wasn't making any sense. And then right. You know, to get validation from that years later, is it just means a lot, you know.
Oh, for sure. And yeah, I want to go back a second. I want to apologize. I think I said Thank You and Goodnight because I'm so used to saying that, but it's Thank You and Goodbye. So I want to mention that. real quick. But big fan of that album. We'll put that aside for right now. But I want to go back to another thing you said, which is, I think right now, I don't think anyone can question the work that you guys are putting in, because not only did you just release a deluxe edition with, you know, two new tracks and two acoustic tracks for Better Moments, but also in 2018, you put out an EP and the full length at the same time, basically. So you did a whole lot of work. I mean, the only other person I know who puts out things on a regular basis like that is Johnny Frank. And Bill Murray, you know, he's just constantly putting out EP after EP. So you don't get to see that very often. So I think right now people looking on the outside are seeing you guys as workhorses.
I mean, that means a lot because we are, first of all, and secondly, you know, to your point earlier, we feel like because we broke up, you know, before, and we've been given the second chance, that like we're gonna have to work that much harder, not only to kill any perception that we were babies or whatever, but secondly, you know, I think that, you know, with coming back and like getting out and touring and seeing fans at these shows for the first time, like. And in our local scene in Detroit, we always did really well, but to actually get out on the road and be like 1,000 miles from home, and like people show up in your t-shirts and know every single word to a song, and that whole experience for that first year that we were back, like, really touched at least me. Yeah. And so it made me just really fucking like just appreciate this. Like, I don't know, you know, I don't know how long our career will last. Nobody does. All I can do is I got to control the things that I can control, and I got to work hard at every opportunity that we're given.
Yeah.
And I am so confident in our abilities that I know if we're given the right opportunities, we'll do well. But, you know, it's just a matter of taking advantage of those opportunities and just working hard, man. Like, I mean, that's just who we are, because we we so much appreciate it. We feel like we owe it to our fans to, you know, because they brought us back to life. So we're going to give it our all.
Absolutely. So I have to say one thing first off. So you want people to show up with your t-shirts on? I still think that that is absolutely unacceptable.
You think that's bad? So I'm assuming did something bad happen with you or?
No. Did you ever watch the movie PCU?
No, I didn't. I'm not a great movie guy. So picky with movies that, I haven't seen it.
It's an old school movie. I think it came out in the 90s, I want to say. And it had Jon Favreau and the guy from Entourage and David Spade. And basically, I think it was Jon Favreau was going to a concert. He was going to see, Funkadelic, P-Funk, Funkadelic, and I can't believe I'm forgetting the entire name there. But he was made fun of because he was wearing the band shirt that he was going to see. And they said, hey, Gutter, don't be that guy. And for
that's
some
hilarious.
Reason, you've never heard that before?
No, that's fucking hilarious, though. I didn't know that was a thing, dude.
Yeah, for years and years, I swear to you, in 2000, like early 2000s, if you showed up to a show where the band was playing, if you were wearing that band's shirt, you would get ridiculed for that.
Dude, that is so funny. I did not know that. That just shows you like how behind on like everything I am. I did not know that was a thing.
Well, no, I can tell you, it's not a thing anymore. It's in my mindset because that's the way I've always been. But
yeah.
Now you show up and you've got 50 people in the same t-shirt. So,
right.
You know, that's not really
dude,
a thing
yeah.
anymore.
Yeah, you'll see the same shirt like right in the front row of the show. It's pretty funny. But right. Yeah, that's crazy. I didn't know that.
Well, I will say for sure. I mean, I'm a very honest person, logical person. So I understand why a band looking out. First of all, they know probably you purchased that shirt. So that's money in their pocket. But then also you're technically showing your support there as well. I think it's just a different mindset that bands had from like early 2000s to now, and how different that mindset is. You know what I mean?
Oh, dude, yeah. I mean, like, that's why I'm laughing at it, is because, like, you know, I think about like where we started, like how things started with us, or like synchronized headbangs, and just like, and old school guys had to fucking look at that shit and were just like, you guys are so stupid. You guys look so dumb. But people ate it up.
Then,
you know, and we've moved away from that too. But yeah, like, just the culture of these shows, you know, like things change over time and kind of quickly sometimes, you know, like I haven't been involved in our local scene as much, over the last few years. And like, I'm not even really sure like who the local band, but they're all the bands we grew up with are gone, you know? And when that happens, a new generation of musicians and showgoers, and like it's its own culture. So like, you know, when it lives and dies, it all changes, you know? So it makes a lot of sense why those little things happen, but it's funny, you know? Yeah.
No, that's why I like bringing it up. because I love having that conversation because it's just so different now. So yeah. And also on the same note of playing live, so I had to miss you guys. I was planning on going to the Palladium show, and then my work told me I had to go to Kentucky for a whole fucking week. So
nice.
Yeah, well, I would have rather been at your show, believe me. So I got to ask, now with, you know, the major changes in the sound of Boys of Fall, how do you guys mix up that set list? Do you guys play mostly things from Chasing Lonely on, or do you play some of the older stuff as well?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, when we first started back, that's a great question because it's a very big challenge for our band. Right. You know, because so I play bass, and obviously our two guitar players. It's not so much with Mike singing and Scott drumming as much as it is just the tunings that all the different tunings that we have are just fucking ridiculous. You know, so that kind of dictates really what kind of set list we put together. But to answer your question, yeah, I mean, we try to pay attention to what people identify our band for, like mm-hmm. what are our big songs and what are the old songs that they still listen to. So yeah, we'll do a little bit of both. I mean, pretty much our set list right now, like on this last headliner consisted of, what did we play? So we opened with, Bad Company. We'll sure. play, Looking on the Bright Side, which is, a single we put out, during our hiatus. That's one of our top songs.
Right.
People just love that song. And in order to do that one live, we transposed it differently. So it's actually played in a different key.
Okay.
But it's also it's easier for the guys to sing. It's like I don't have to do a bass switch or anything. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. And after that one, we'll go into Something to Say. And then, you know, depending on the night, like we'll throw Novocaine in. We'll slow it down. I really enjoy doing that. I think that like a lot of people because it gets quiet, you know, like to. We do like a lot of acoustic stuff anyways. And so throw that little bit of, soft, chill element into the live set, I think really sets us apart.
Mm-hmm.
I think we do it well. So yeah, we'll play Novocaine sometimes. Fake Smiles, the new one.
Sure. Yep.
I'm trying to remember. Yeah. We'll, you know, Chasing Lonely will get played. We'll end with No Good For Me. And then if we get encored, we'll play like It's Always Sunny in Arkadelphia.
Ah, okay.
So yeah, I took the long way to answer. Sorry for rambling.
It's fine. No problem.
But yeah, we try to mix and match. And I would say that definitely it's just like all the tunings switch things up. So in order to play those songs, like we just typically sit down and practice and we'll transpose them. So that first of all, it's in Mike's singing range.
Right.
And then secondly, like we don't have to do any like crazy guitar switches, like, you know, in the middle of the set, like. We used to take a ton of fucking guitars with us out on tour, and like we're not Van Halen, dude. Like, you know, like all the venues we play are just like limited space and stuff. So it's just like as much as of the set list that we can condense onto one guitar, like that's the goal.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. I mean, that just makes sense logically to be able to kind of condense.
Yeah.
A little bit to make that stuff easier for you guys for sure. So you mentioned you play Fake Smiles. And I thought one of the big things that was interesting for me was when you went from Better Moments to Better Moments, the Gold Edition, you added Fake Smiles to it and you added it as the first track
mm-hmm.
of that deluxe. And Fake Smiles kind of brings back some of that more old school Boys of Fall sound. You've got a little bit more screaming in there. It's a little bit more maybe easy core-y. You know, depending mm-hmm. on how you want to genre-nize.
Mm-hmm.
So was that put in there as a direct response for, you know, fans that were like, hey, this is such a big sound change?
It wasn't. Yeah. That's exactly what it was. I'm really sensitive to what our fans say because I love them. You know, like they give me a reason to wake up in the morning to be able to do this. And, you know, Mike and I are both pretty sensitive to it. So I think a lot of the. You know, and on top of it, dude, like, Mike won't say this, but since he's not here, I can hype him up. He is a world-class vocalist. He is so, so talented. And he's so talented on the screaming end of things too, that mm-hmm. for us not to incorporate that into our music is a bad thing, you know? And gotcha. I think we realized after we got Better Moments back and we really listened to it a lot, although we're proud of it and we're happy with it, we felt like we left a lot on the table.
Ah, okay.
You know, but also like it was a step in the right direction for us. Mm-hmm. And so like these two new tracks, particularly Fake Smiles, you know, was like, yo, like we're moving in this groovy direction, you know, where it's going to be dancey and stuff and bouncy, but, and catchy, you know, and there's going to be R&B elements into what we're doing, but we're not going to stop being aggressive.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Oh yeah. So, I mean, that was a strategic thing, was like, I was just like, I want our fans, like, if we're going to put this thing out, like, I want our fans to hear that, like, we hear them, you know, like, mm-hmm. we're hearing you, and I want the first track to just knock them dead, you know?
Right. You want to make fans happy, but you also want to be happy with what you have to play and listen to over and over and over again. So The question would be, you know, you mentioned a long, long way back when we were talking, you mentioned the word maturity with the steps that you're taking right now. So do you see not using screaming as much, or, you know, not doing breakdowns as much? Do you see that as maturing into what you're doing right now?
That's a great question. I would say it's more so, I think when I'm referring to maturity, I'm referring to not doing shit just for the sake of doing it. I would say, sure, what we're trying to do is, like, if the part calls for a scream, fucking scream. Don't put any rules on what we're doing, you know. Yeah. I think when we first started writing music, it's just like, I want to write a heavy song. Well, these are the rules for writing a heavy song within the genre. So sure, we got to go drop B, and we got to do this, and we got to do these riffs. And it's just like, you know, although like those old songs gave us a platform to start with, like, it's not, I don't think it was, some of those things were the right moves for us to make in that regard. And I think that we're so talented with our musician, like with our lineup now, that it would be us settling for anything less than just like writing something pure, like in the moment, and not being afraid to do it, you know?
Right.
So if that means writing a super poppy song, then that's what we're going to do. And if it means writing an acoustic song, that's what we're going to do. If it means writing a heavier song, that's exactly what we're going to do.
Yeah.
You know, I guess it means just not putting too many rules on ourselves.
I like that definition. I think everyone has, you know, I'm sure you've seen it, you know, especially if you're keeping track of the music industry, especially our scene, when you hear people talk about bands that have changed their sound, they often use, it's almost a defense mechanism. If you've got the fans defending a band for completely changing their sound, they're often saying, oh, this band has matured, or this band has evolved, because both of those words are normally used as a positive. But there are definitely bands that have taken a huge step back in their musicianship and what they're putting out there because they decided on going in a poppier direction. I don't believe that you guys have done that, because I think you can hear it. You're still using instruments. I think that's the big thing, to be completely honest. You're still using instruments, and you're still writing a coherent, well-written song. You're not, like, I don't hear, when I listen to your music, I don't hear it like, oh, they're trying to sound like they're going to appeal to a 14-year-old girl. You know what I mean?
No, exactly. Yeah, I would even totally agree. And I would say that, like, just the lyrical content of our band as well is mature, you know? So, yeah, dude, I don't think that for us, there's been a lot of bands that I grew up listening to that, you know, changed drastically for the worse. And I didn't want to become that band, you know? And I think that, like, in retrospect, like, looking back from, like, Better Moments to Thank You and Goodbye, I hope that we didn't do that to too many people with the change. It was just, you know, it felt like a step in the right direction. Each one of these songs, like, were such a challenge for me as a musician, like, personally, that it was just like, man, if I'm really pouring myself into this, how can it be bad?
Right.
You know, that we wouldn't be betraying our fans because I'm staying true to myself. And this is who I am right now in this moment. You know, I often tell people that an album or an album cycle or a snapshot of what's going on in that artist's life at that moment, you know, at least when you're self-writing, you know, and
for sure.
So yeah, it felt like a step in the right direction, and we worked really hard on it.
Yeah,
it was just unique, man. I mean, like, I look back on that time, and I think, like, first of all, like, Thank You and Goodbye is a compilation of songs that over a 4-year period of time, like, those, some of those songs are really old.
Yeah,
and you know, we were instructed to just sit on all this music by our management at the time. So like, wow. Nobody heard, you know, so by the time it comes out in 2016, I mean, some of those songs are like 3-4 years old at the time, you wow. know? And even when it came out, like that wasn't who we were anymore, you know?
Ah, okay.
You know, and when it came out, when the world finally heard it, you know, we had a completely different lineup than when some of those songs were written too. That's a lot true. Of people yep. don't know that, you mm-hmm. know? So yeah, dude, it's a snapshot in time, and all you can do is just like try to progress as best you can and stay true to yourself. And, when we came back and like you said, I mean, we pumped out so much music. It was just like, and that time frame was just such a whirlwind.
Oh yeah.
You know, and I think that, I don't think we forgot who we were at the time, but I think that we just kind of got lost a little bit in it, in that whirlwind. And so, yeah, I think that, you know, for this next album cycle, you know, we're going to talk to the label about self-producing and self-recording, because actually, No Good For Me, Novocaine, Fake Smiles, Smooth mm-hmm. Yaz, and then all of Thank You and Goodbye, all those songs are self-recorded and self-produced.
Yeah, right.
So we want to get back to that because we feel super, super comfortable in that environment. And we feel like we won't make any sacrifices on our sound. It'll be true to who we are while also taking a step forward, you know?
Right. Well, you worked with Andrew Wade on the last couple of releases, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so, I mean, he's had his fingers in, I mean, The Ghost Inside, especially, you know, A Day to Remember. He's done so many of those styles of bands. He's been all over the place. But when you worked on this stuff with him, was it kind of ironic to not be working on as much as that more easy core post hardcore style of music and working more on this pop punk, you know, R&B infused rock, you know, poppy rock, however you want to say it? Was it kind of ironic working with him on that and not your previous material?
Oh, definitely, dude. Yeah, it was. The whole fact that, you know, our entire career up to that point, people would just be like, oh, you guys are knockoff A Day to Remember. And then to end up working with their producer.
Right.
You know, and then we met Jeremy from A Day to Remember one day. He just popped into the studio one day and like we all almost shit our pants. but dude, yeah, like it was ironic, but at the same time, he was the right man for the job. He taught us so much.
Oh, it's great.
And dude, he really wanted to work with us, like personally, because we did Chasing Lonely with him, and he had such a good time with it that it was just like when we did the full length, like that's what he wanted to do. He mm-hmm. wanted to work with us again, and he kind of moved mountains to make it happen, you know.
Oh, okay.
So like he definitely did not have to work with us, but he wanted to, and he was so much fun. Again, taught us a lot, and the guy works really, really, really hard. It's no wonder, like, you know, people attribute his success to A Day to Remember, and I think to an extent, rightfully so.
Sure.
But at the same time, like, if you watch that guy work, that guy is at his studio at like 7, 8 o'clock in the morning and doesn't leave till 10 o'clock at night.
Nice.
You know,
yeah, yeah.
He is just a guy that's just working hard at his craft at all times.
Yeah.
On top of himself, he's a great musician himself.
That's what I've heard. Yeah.
Yeah, he showed me some of his solo stuff that he was working on and just blew me away. I just loved spending time with that guy.
Yeah.
You know, and he's a very humble guy. You would never know that he's a very successful producer and he's worked with huge bands. You'd never know that.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, just a great guy. We loved it.
Welcome back, everyone. Now, this is a very honest show. I know you just heard the technical difficulties song. So what actually happened was, while Eli was giving me great answers on the questions that I was asking. One of the mic cords that I had used for years just basically melted. And as he was talking, I realized that I could not piece everything together. We are now live again on another day. So I wanted to make sure, just in case things sound a little bit different, that everyone knows what happened. I really appreciate Eli coming back and being able to go over this again. So Eli, welcome back.
Thank you for having me. Glad to be back.
No problem, man. We'll make it seem like this just never happened, and we will move on really quick here. And my follow-up question to what you were talking about with Andrew Wade was that it seems like you had mentioned that you guys were basically going to go ahead no matter what producer and really try and do this all by yourself maybe in the next album cycle.
Yeah, yeah. And obviously, nothing's for sure. You know, we kind of talked a little bit with the label about it. You know, obviously they have to approve anything that we do, but I'm not sure. It's been a couple of days, so I can't remember where we're leaving off. But we feel really confident in our abilities to self-produce,
right?
You know, and you know, a lot of our top streaming songs were actually, you know, songs we recorded and produced ourselves. That being like Novocaine and No Good for Me,
right?
The entire Thank You and Goodbye record. You know, so I think from our perspective, I just think that we just kind of want to take control of our careers again. And that starts with the product that we make for everyone to consume. And that's our music. You know, I think straight up, it's not a matter of anyone did us dirty or anything. I just think that we learned so much from Andrew. And I think that we just want to go in a direction that's just, yeah, I hope it doesn't sound like we're trying to be closed off or anything. I just think that we're trying to take control back of our career. And I think we're at the level now where, you know, every little decision we make is super, super important. Like I mentioned before in the interview, you know, bands our size, it's just so competitive.
Right.
So we want to do something that we feel is going to separate ourselves from the middle tier. You know, there's a lot of mid-level bands right now vying for a lot of different spots, and we feel like we know how to develop our own sound in a way.
Yeah, no, that makes complete sense. Now, obviously, you guys are going to hopefully be able to do that, but you had also mentioned before about working with Johnny Frank, possibly. You have experience with him. It might be something where you guys could be very collaborative, but he would let you do kind of whatever you wanted. And now, if people go back and they listen to Thank You and Goodbye, there are actually two tracks on there that are labeled Johnny Frank mixes. So how did that relationship form in the beginning?
Yeah, Johnny, let's see. Well, how it all started was we were self-recording and producing. We were a local band at the time. This was back in 2013, 2014. And our first manager picked us up, and he was managing a band I wouldn't say they were local at the time. They had just signed to Hopeless Records. They were called Sycamore.
Oh, yeah.
And he was managing Sycamore at the time, and all of their music was being recorded and produced by Johnny. And as soon as we got picked up by our manager at the time, he said, I'd like you guys to go record one of your demos with Johnny.
Ah.
Actually, no, that's wrong. So we actually went, he said, I want you guys to go record a cover with Johnny.
Oh,
and,
okay.
That was the Amnesia cover.
Gotcha.
So that was the first song we ever did with Johnny. It was just like, and as soon as we got down to his recording space, I mean, within the first 20 minutes, we were laughing and joking and having a good time. And that was our first time ever working with somebody else outside of ourselves,
wow.
In a creative environment, you know? Yeah. And we just kicked it right off, and we've been really, really good friends ever since. So yeah, he, you know, we just vibed creatively. He really, really was excited about us. And you know, a lot of the guys in the band had listened to Attack Attack back when they were kids, you know, 100%. So, the respect was obviously there for Johnny and his abilities and what he had done in music in general, you know, so, he was just one of our guys from the very beginning. We trusted him very quickly, and he just made a lot of our, he pushed us, you know, and then he made a lot of our ideas come to life. And so after Amnesia, we went back down to record My Promise to Maryland. which was the first single we ever like really put out that kind of put like a pop punk, you know, sound to our, you know, everything before that had been really post-hardcore.
Right.
And then, you know, we had a whole stockpile of demos, which a lot of them now are on Thank You and Goodbye. But at the time, we were talking about putting an EP together and shopping it around to labels. And so we were just like, it was just like, let's go record it with Johnny. So yeah, we actually recorded, you know, almost, I mean, an entire EP with Johnny that, and only two of those songs with Johnny ended up getting released on Thank You and Goodbye. But the rest of the EP became Thank You and Goodbye. And we re-recorded that ourselves and all that. But yeah, so we've actually worked a lot with Johnny, and we would love to work with him again in the future. Obviously we haven't quite pitched the idea to him about like, we've just kind of talked about it. And then we did like a short run with Bill Murray.
Yeah.
You know, so nothing is set in stone. These are all just things that are being talked about right now, but I would be really excited to work with Johnny in some capacity again. He's such a talented guy.
Oh yeah.
A very, very dear friend. And we would just love to work with him again if we could.
Absolutely, man. Well, I got to ask again about a different collaboration that you had relatively recently. There's another band in Michigan that I'm a big fan of called Desires. And you guys did a feature on their song Bruises that came out recently, maybe like a year and a half ago, somewhere around there. But what I thought was pretty interesting was instead of just naming Mike as the feature, it says featuring Boys of Fall. Did you guys all get together to do that? Or was it just simply that, you know, Mike lent his voice for that?
I think it was more Mike. Yeah, I didn't really have a part of that. And, you know, back then, man, we were just getting going again. So it was probably, he probably involved Jake on that as well. That's probably why it's labeled Boys of Fall. But yeah, I wasn't a part of that.
Oh, okay. I had to check because I had Desires. I had Steve from Desires on the show, I want to say at least twice, maybe even three times. And I remember that track coming out, and that sounded like your new sound mixed with this melodic hardcore, and it came out very well. So that's the only reason why I was going into that, but that's interesting. Okay, so we'll move on from that for sure. What is the future? You talk about, you know, making new music. Are you guys going to be doing another tour coming up? Are you going to start writing? What is your guys' plan?
Yeah, so in the short term, what we have booked right now, we've got like a Halloween show in Bay City, Michigan. Nice. That's coming up in October. We've got a couple shows in Canada. Oh. We're playing a festival in Canada with Seaway and a whole bunch of other bands. And then on the way back home, we'll be playing a one-off show in Buffalo, New York.
Nice.
And then we'll be off for all of November, but then we have our first annual holiday show in Detroit, which is our, you know, our home base, at St. Andrew's Hall. It's going to be December 14th.
Very cool.
It's going to be a really, really big deal. We actually are, you know, going to do this every year in conjunction with Live Nation. And we're really, really honored to do such a thing. We just want to throw a huge, like, homecoming show every year. You know, and it's a big venue. It's a legendary venue, and I'm so, so excited about it. So yeah, we're going to end the year that way. In the meantime, we're going to keep writing our record. And in the long term, man, we actually just signed with Feta Booking Agency.
Yeah.
You know, and that's a really big deal for us because we've gone our entire career without an agent.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, I mean, we've done all this touring. Our manager has a background in booking, but he's not a booking agent. He's a manager, and he's booked all of our tours, basically. So I'm really excited about the opportunity to be submitted for any kind of support tours next year. I mean, I really see it being very busy for us, releasing a record next year and supporting it, and supporting other bands. So, yeah, in the long term, that's the plan, is just getting out there, seeing our fans, and making new ones.
Very cool, man. No, that's great. And that's why I like to ask that, just to see where your guys' head is at. So let me also ask, just based on the Halloween show, do you already know what you're dressing up as?
Oh, man. We've talked about it. Oh, it's so funny you asked, because we played a There was a notorious Halloween show in Detroit that we always played. And the first year that we played it, I told the guys, and this was before Star Wars came back. I was like, yeah. Guys, we got to be Star Wars. So Mike was Darth Vader and the rest of us were stormtroopers.
Nice.
And it was fucking awesome. It was so dope. And then the year after that, we were all minions.
Ah, sure.
So that was fun. A lot of people loved it. So one year, a long, long time ago, we were Power Rangers.
Nice. Nice.
It was a horrible show. So I don't think that we'll ever do that again. Bad luck on that one.
Yep.
But yeah, we've talked about it a little bit. We're definitely going to do something though. Haven't decided yet, but yeah, I think something's in the works.
More in that kind of group costume type thing though.
Oh, for sure, man. And it's funny. I'm really proud of like I said, we've always done a really good job. Like, you know, the year that we were Stormtroopers and Darth Vader, like we came out to the Imperial March song.
Ah, sure.
As an intro, it was so dope. And then for the Minions, I forgot they've got like the Minions have a song in the movie.
I hate to tell you this, I've never seen it. I have no idea.
Yeah, I forget how it goes, but it was hilarious. People loved it.
Oh yeah,
but yeah, we always try to do a good job of entertaining. You know what I mean? And that's just part of it. So
now it seems like you guys have the personality to be able to pull that kind of thing off.
Yeah, we're so outgoing. And I like, it's funny, man. Like I grew up like just really kind of not really cool, for lack of a better term. And it's so funny because like this dude named Sean, and he might have even forgotten that he made this Facebook post, but his name's Sean. He plays in a band called Gold Root.
Okay.
They're really, really good. And he made a Facebook status one day that said, I'm tired of seeing all these band dudes acting like they're cool. Like the whole reason why you play music is because you were never cool. Like that's why you played music. And I don't know if that's true for everybody, but that was definitely true for me. That was not cool at all. still not very cool. And that's why I play music. So, point being is like when I'm in a show environment, like that's where I thrive. You know what I mean? And the guys are the same way. It's the whole experience. It's not just being on stage. Like I just love getting in touch with people. It's funny. We played, back in, God, I think it was 2015.
Mm-hmm.
We played, back when I Prevail first blew up.
Oh, sure.
We opened for them at the Crowfoot in Pontiac, and there was this huge line, you know, to get in because it was a sold out show. And I just went out into the line and just started hanging out with people, taking pictures with them, and you know, just like who are you here to see or what. So anytime I see a line for a show, like I'm always out there talking to people. And it's funny, like we shot our music video for our song Pass Me By.
Yep.
And the very beginning is me like just talking to as many people as I can talk to. That's just, yeah. So sorry for rambling, but yeah,
oh, no.
The show environment is where we thrive. We love it. And our personalities we just eat it up. We love seeing people. We love entertaining.
Right. No, absolutely. And just kind of go back a little bit talking about being uncool. When we were talking off the air, you mentioned that you're a Celtics fan, right?
I am indeed.
Very, very uncool. Very uncool.
Yeah.
How did that happen?
I'll tell you what. So I grew up a Pistons fan, and we made the Eastern Conference Finals like so many years in a row. Mm. And actually, after the Spurs Game 7 loss
baby.
In 05.
Woo! Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. That's my team.
Oh, okay. Oh, you're a Spurs fan.
Yeah, since I was 3 years old.
Oh man. Okay. Well, you got more claim to your team than I do because I jumped on the bandwagon in 08.
Yeah.
With the big three, I was always a big KG fan, and I've just fell in love with that squad. I mean, I you know, obviously they won a lot, but
sure.
I loved Rondo.
Ah, gotcha.
Back then, I thought his peak, when he was at his peak, I thought he was the best point guard in the league.
Right.
You know, he was the OG triple-double machine. You know, I remember the one game against, remember when Jeremy Lin had his run?
Oh, yeah.
And the Celtics ended up playing, it was in the middle of Lin's sanity, and they played on a Sunday. It was like the ABC Sunday showcase.
Yep.
And Rondo had like 26 assists and like 15 rebounds, and like just he just destroyed. Went off on Jeremy Lin, and I was just like, I just missed that, just that tough squad with Doc Rivers as a coach.
Oh, yeah.
I miss KG and
sure.
Yeah, that was my squad, man.
Well, look, I can't hold it against you. I can't do that for sure. I mean, that was a team full of personality. And for me,
yeah.
I mean, living in Boston, it was a little tough because it was just shoved down your throat all the time and being a Spurs fan. But Doc Rivers, he was a Spur.
Yeah.
So at least I had that. Yeah, that wasn't too bad for me. But it's just funny how you're able, or you were able in this case, to transfer that fandom over. Is there anyone else, you know, now? So you're living in Michigan, right?
That's right.
Yeah. So is there any other team that you love that is actually outside of Michigan?
In not so much in the NBA, but for college basketball, I'm a big Kentucky fan. And this one is funny because a lot of people jump on that bandwagon, but I've been a Kentucky fan since I was born, because my grandma was from Kentucky. And she was a really special person. She played semi-pro softball.
Oh, nice. Nice.
Yeah, she was a tough tough lady, man, and she was a teacher, she was just an avid sports fan. She was really, really smart, very, very sweet. And she lived in Kentucky even as I was growing up, but her and my grandpa would come up to Michigan every 6 weeks to visit. And she is the whole reason why I love sports, because nobody in my family likes sports. I'm the only one. And when I was a kid, that's what me and my grandma would do. She'd just come up and she'd just pop on ESPN, and she didn't care what was on. So I grew up watching women's basketball, you know, men's, sure. College. She wasn't a big fan of the NBA, but we watched football together. We watched a lot of basketball together. And so, yeah, I'm always rooting for the Wildcats. And actually the year that the last time we won the title, I think it was 2012 or 2013.
Okay.
When Anthony Davis was on the squad.
Oh, yeah.
That year, that was the year she actually passed away. So we got to share that together before she passed away. So yeah, the Wildcats are very near and dear to my heart.
That makes sense, man. That definitely makes sense. All right, Eli, I think that is the perfect place to end tonight. I believe when I put these two sections together, we'll be around an hour or so. But man, I really enjoyed that conversation. I'm definitely going to have you on. And then obviously, we talked about how I missed your last show. I'm hoping that, you know, the next time you guys are touring around, you'll be able to make it up here as well. And I'll definitely go out and see you guys again. So I want to make sure to mention to everyone out there, go out, listen to Better Moments. There's a gold edition out right now, the deluxe edition through InVogue Records. And then just like Eli said, check their tour dates, see if you can get on, you know, one of these dates. But until then, Eli, what is the best way for people to support you guys?
First and foremost, check us out on Spotify.
Absolutely.
Check out Boys of Fall on Spotify. Hit us up on Instagram at Boys of Fall Band. Hit us up on Facebook. Twitter, they're all at Boys of Fall Band. Stop by our merch store, pick up a t-shirt if you like what you hear. If not, just come out to a show, man. Come out and meet us.
Yeah.
We love to meet new people. That we're all about the people, man.
Yeah.
So yeah, come out to a show, hang out with us, get a sweaty hug from us after we get done playing, and yeah.
Sounds great, man. And look, I will have links in the description of the episode with all those links that you mentioned. We'll try and make this as simple as possible for everyone. But once again, man, this was on short notice. It was awesome that you were able to fill in. I'm so glad I got a chance to talk to you. Like I mentioned off air, and I think on air too, I am a fan of Boys of Fall. So this is really fun for me to get to know your personality and really get into the, you know, the quote unquote nitty gritty of everything that you guys have been through. And I'm just looking forward to more music, more touring, just more stuff from you guys. So once again, man, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Oh man, it means the world to me that you're a fan. Thank you very much for having me. I had a great time. You're a great interviewer and I'd love to come back.
You've been listening to Scene Daddy Interviews.
Thank you all for listening to Scene Daddy Interviews. Make sure you support the artists we featured by checking out the summary of the episode. Also, for all your scene news, reviews, and memes, make sure to follow Scene Daddy and Ian Hates on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and don't forget to subscribe and rate Scene Daddy Interviews on your favorite podcast listening app for more great artist interviews in the future. Stay seen.